Most of these you'll hear better with the diaphragm. And then the next one that's, and that's the same with seasoned clinicians, be able to tell if it's a crescendo or decrescendo type murmur, or if it's a whole, like a holosystolic, they'll say holosystolic, it just blows all the way across systole, whether it kind of goes up and down during systole. And then, but the big one for clinicians and people who are learning what these things mean are, what does it do with different maneuvers that I put the patient into? Like, does it change with posture? Does it change with Valsalva? Does it change with deep breaths? Which side of the heart would you suspect a murmur is coming from if there's a big change with respiration? Or with breathing in or out?
Right.
You would think it's coming from the right side of the heart, and that's right. So this is my favorite diagram again. And they're like it so much, then they're twice. I think my point on this was just to look again that where you're hearing it isn't necessarily directly over the valve itself. It's where the blood is going where you're hearing the sound. Here's how you will grade them. You could barely hear it after listening really hard to grade one. Most of them are going to be a 2 to 3 that you're going to hear. Really loud murmurs, a 4. And then if it's really loud and you can actually feel that thrill, that vibratory sensation under your fingers, that's a 5. And if you don't even need the stethoscope to hear it, it's a 6. That'll be a really bad murmur. It could be a little kid, you know. Okay. Again about the thrills. So if they got really severe mitral regurg, you might see a thrill on the left side of the chest. If they got really severe aortic regurg, you might see it on the right over that aortic position. And then what are your most common murmurs? Your most common murmurs are systolic murmurs. And those are your top 3 right there. Aortic stenosis is the biggie. And especially in America, where we don't have a lot of rheumatic fever anymore. So this is mostly due to age and or degeneration and or atherosclerosis. You actually get atherosclerotic change to the aortic valve. And then your other two are going to be mitral fever, mitral valve prolapse. How do you think about murmurs when you hear them? Is your first thing you want to figure out is, does it increase with deep inspiration? If it increases with deep inspiration, you're automatically over to the right side of the heart, off the page, on the right side of the heart. So you're looking at tricuspid regurg or pulmonic stenosis, which are much less common. Those are going to be your more rare murmurs. If the murmur does not change with inspiration, the next thing to narrow yourself down is, does it increase with Valsalva? So you have the patient bear down, which is increasing preload to the heart. If they're hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, that's going to increase the murmur sound. You may even hear a gallop when you do that. Which gallop would you hear? It's hypertrophic, stiff walls.
Four.
Mm-hmm. You probably hear a 4. So if it does increase with Valsalva, probably dealing with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. If it doesn't, the next test you're going to do is hand grip. Hand grip increases afterload. If increasing afterload causes the sound to intensify, then it's a valvular disease inside the left side of the heart. It's either probably mitral regurg or aortic stenosis. Excuse me. It increases with hand grip, because if we're already on that side of the heart, if it doesn't worsen with Valsalva, and then if we afterload it, it's going to get worse if it's mitral regurg. It's not going to intensify if it's aortic stenosis. So y'all can work this out in your brain later. You'll have to look at it again as you're reading. But that chart I thought was pretty helpful. And this is what you have on your page. So these are the ones that you're going to run into at some point in time. Some of this on here is, you know, common sense, like where are you going to hear aortic stenosis? In the aortic position, right? So right second intercostal space. It's going to be systolic. Usually aortic stenosis is harsh and pretty loud, and it's crescendo decrescendo. And we'll listen to these in a minute. Now, whether or not you can tell it sounds like a gull or a dove, just kind of put that in there, just kind of forgive it. But, and it will radiate to the carotid arteries. What causes it? It's usually calcification of the valve. Can be due to bicuspid. Could be rheumatic fever. Could be degeneration of atherosclerosis. So your other big systolic murmur is mitral regurg due to incompetence of the mitral valve, and it's going to sound different. So both of those are going to be systolic, but we'll listen to them a minute. You should be able to tell the difference between an aortic stenosis murmur and a mitral regurg murmur. If you can't distinguish it by how it sounds, how else could you distinguish it? By its location, right? So you hear a systolic murmur, you know, doesn't change with inspiration. So knowing what you know about what are the most common murmurs, you know it's probably going to be aortic stenosis or mitral regurg. Well, then you don't know, have them, you know, listen here. Both position is upright. Now this chart says increases with inspiration, whereas on my other chart I don't have it on there. So I'm going to say for studying purposes, we're going to say all the systolic murmurs are not bothered by inspiration, okay? So what I want y'all to know about inspiration is it's loading the right heart. You get really good at hearing them someday. You can distinguish all the other little tiny things. And I gave you the picture of the heart, because to me, I like to see where the blood is going. I thought y'all might want to make notes on that. Then your mitral valve prolapse. The way you're going to tell the difference in that is you're going to hear a snap with that one. Okay. And I'm kind of jumping around the page, but aortic regurg is not quite, and it's not as common as aortic stenosis, and it's going to be one of your most common diastolic murmurs. So y'all can look this, read on from this later. We're going to listen to them. So your less common murmurs that you're going to see in adults are tricuspid issues. Pulmonic stenosis is pretty rare. You will need to be able to distinguish ventricular septal defects. And then the patient ductus arteriosus, you will probably have a test question or a board question that will call it machine-like. Harsh, loud, continuous murmur that's machine-like, not by posture. That will probably be on an exam or a board question at some point. I'd love to ask that. And it's kind of all over. Like, it doesn't favor any location. You'll just kind of hear it in every position equally. Now, how you can tell the VSD, the ventricular septal defect, is it'll sound like an aortic stenosis, kind of, but it doesn't radiate. You know, it's not going to radiate to their carotid arteries. And these are murmurs, if they're really loud, they're going to find these in kids pretty early on. And here again, you can study this later. This is kind of tells you what the maneuvers do to each murmur. And if you can work it out in your brain, figuring out, okay, that increases preload, so that's going to make this sound a lot louder, or this increases afterload, this murmur is going to sound a lot louder. You'll just have to study this. I mean, I could stand up here and repeat it all to you, but you just kind of have to look at it and work it out in your brain. Now, murmurs can be normal. That's the other thing, too, especially in kids that are thin. And so here are areas, especially on a child, that you can just hear a murmur, and it's not necessarily anything pathologic at all. But if you heard one, you would probably get an echo, just to be sure. All right, before we go to Bruce, let's listen to some rough. I'm just going to play one. Y'all tell me what it is. I'm just kidding. Okay. This is, well, let's just listen and see.
Thank you.
soft ones are harder to hear. So we go like love duck, love duck, love duck, love duck. You know, hear it just right after the dove. This is aortic regurge. We'll play it again. It'd be hard to distinguish that between an S4. Also diastolic. This one is mitral stenosis. And this person's laying in lateral, left lateral decubitus. That's why it sounds a little bit funny, doesn't it? Because you're not listening over the aortic position or the mitral position. You're listening to the mitral position, but they're laying, so it sounds different. Yes. I'll play it again. There's quite a bit more. This says it has an opening snap as well. I have a hard time hearing it. Sounds rough. You want to listen to several cycles of, you know, several cardiac cycles, because you may catch something on a different beat that it doesn't do every time consistently. So listen for quite a while. Now let's go back here. Again, let's listen to normal now that we've been doing this murmur. So let's listen to normal again. Back to normal. Ground yourself. Okay. Now, let me see if you guys can hear splitting of S2. Radiating to like the carotids. You always want to use the bell for Bruies. Bell for Bruies. They're very low pitched and quiet. So where do you listen to breweries at? Well, we know, you can listen to the temporal arteries, you guys aren't gonna do that, that's not on your checklist. But you're definitely gonna do aortic, and you're gonna wanna listen to the aortic, or the aortic, carotids, and you'll definitely wanna do that, one at a time. When you palpate is what I'm thinking of. Always palpate, don't palpate both carotids at the same time. So listen to your carotids for breweries, one at a time, you only have one stethoscope and 2 years. Then you're gonna listen to one position for the aorta, two positions each renal artery, two positions each iliac artery, and then you're gonna verbalize if you're doing the femorals. We're not gonna get all in the business when we do our SPVLs, but you need to know they're like right over the groin. I didn't put any sounds for breweries in. They sound sort of like a murmur. So just listen to a lot of normals, and then you'll know when you hear a brew. You'll know it's not normal. Pulses. We all know what a pulse is. We all know that it correlates with cardiac output. I mean, if somebody's hypovolemic, unstable, they've lost a lot of blood, they're probably going to have a puny pulse, right? Somebody's in a panic attack and they're having a ton of adrenaline pumped through, they're going to have a bounding fast pulse, right? So it correlates with cardiac output. So what points are you going to palpate for pulses? So for your SPVLs, you're going to do carotids. Everybody knows where radial is because we did it for vitals. And you're going to want to, for the purpose of a cardiac evaluation, you're going to palpate both simultaneously. Ulnar, other side of the wrist. Everybody can palpate their own ulnar artery and radial artery. Everybody remember where the brachial is? The same thing you're occluding for blood pressure. Include your brachial pulse here. Your aortic pulse is right there in the midline of the abdomen. Femoral pulses. Everybody can palpate. Go home, palpate your own femoral pulses. And we'll call it good. And then your popliteal pulses are in the back of your knee. Should be able to feel those. If you had a foot that looked like it needed to be amputated, probably want to check the popliteal pulse, right? And then dorsalis pedis and posterior tibial. So dorsalis pedis is right there. Should be able to palpate that pretty easy. And then posterior tibialis, for some people like mine, you can see the pulse.
Right.
You see it? Anybody see it?
Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
I can see it
from here. That's right there, medial to the ankle. High blood pressure.
Can't see it.
So when I have strokes in the day, I'll know why.
We'll save you.
She's like, please go. She's talking
about it. You gotta
go on
your test.
Only if we can show.
Only resuscitate good brains.
Is the popliteal?
Yeah, popliteal is just right in the fossa, right in the popliteal fossa. And you can kind of see on here. Don't palpate pulses with your thumbs. I mean, I have a pulse in my thumb. I mean, I like to use my third and fourth to palpate the pads. I don't use my index because I have a pulse in it as well. So I just kind of like to use those two. When you're palpating pulses, I mean, who has palpated atrial fibrillation? Anybody? Yeah, no, Professor Reggie has. I mean, that's the big one. Like, palpate the pulse and figure out if they're an AFib or not. I mean, it's just gonna have to make no rhyme or reason at all. So we'll talk about the difference because there's some irregular beats that are actually regular. We'll get that in a minute. So pulse rate naturally rises with deep inspiration. There's a reflex that goes from the atria. Again, when you load the right side of the heart, it causes the heart to beat faster. There's a reflex pathway that when that right side of the heart is loaded, it sends a message because it expects that, am I not putting out enough cardiac output on the left? Why is my right heart loaded? And so it'll tell the heart to be faster by bypassing any consciousness at all. So naturally, you can practice that on your friends and spouses. If you take deep inspiration, should speed the pulse up just a bit. Here's how you grade pulses. You'll get good at feeling contour. You actually feel how the pulse wave looks, which takes a lot of practice. Mostly what I want you guys to know is when you're palpating a pulse, is what is the rate? Is the rhythm regular? Is there a rhyme or reason to the rhythm? Is it making sense? How intense is the pulse? And then contour for test questions. You'll feel contour at some point, but right now I'll teach you what the differences are. Carotid arteries are best for feeling the contour of the pulse, because it's right from the heart. It is the most direct spot that the blood is going to. So let me just throw this out there. So look at the contour of F on the water hammer pulse. If a normal pulse kind of has a little bit of a rounded top to it, what disease or what valvular disease in the heart that you probably also would hear a murmur would cause the blood to just collapse from itself? It's regurg of the aortic valve. So it's just blowing out, but since you've got aortic regurg, it's just falling back down. So the water hammer pulse will just be a collapsing pulse because the heart, the left ventricle is not able to throw all the blood out. It's falling back in through the incompetent aortic valve. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. We'll get some more of those in a minute. Then you'll see these on telemetry, like when you're in the hospital and walk in the room and see what the pulse looks like, but you can also feel it. So I want you to kind of coordinate between what it feels like and what it should look like on a monitor. So there's your water hammer pulse. It's jerky, it collapses, it just is the pretty much the aortic valve is incompetent, so the what should be going out is just falling back on itself. Aortic regurg. Pulsus bisferiens, or a bifid pulse, is you'll be able to palpate that if you get really good, because it will feel like it's almost two beats at the top. And that's because it's aortic. It's not just regurg. This one's stenosis, and it's kind of pushing it through, working harder to get it through a stenotic aortic valve. And it has a little bit of regurg as well. But the bifid pulse or the bisferiens pulse is always due to aortic disease as well. The other one you need to know, or there's several of these you need to know, but the next one you need to know is pulsus paradoxus. Pulsus paradoxus goes with inspiration. So what should your pulse do when you take a deep breath? Speed up. This one, the amplitude of the pulse, the pressure of the pulse goes down as you take a deep breath. So take a deep breath, you load the right side of the heart, it should speed up and pick up, but it can't. The pressure falls because it can't put the blood out, and it's almost always cardiac tamponade. You can also see it in constrictive pericarditis, but that should be tamponade, you need to get an echo quickly. And this, again, this seems weird because we talk about jugular venous distension, right? So Those two things go together. So jugular venous distension, pulsus paradoxus, or if you're seeing both of those things, it's cardiac tamponade, pretty much. You can make that clinical call. Alternans is where you get alternating changes in the intensity of the pulse. So you'll have a really good beat and then you'll have a crappy beat. You have a really good beat and you'll have a crappy beat. Because the heart's not able to work as hard as it needs to work every beat because the heart's in left ventricular failure usually. So it's not able to put out a good beat every beat. It's taking a break every other one. That's why I like to think of alternans as alternating in the intensity. It's because the heart is incapable of putting that good beat out every beat. So it's LV failure. And surprisingly, this one's actually better felt in the distal arteries and not in the carotids, because the carotid pressure is really high. So you can actually feel alternans better if you're in the distal extremities. Radial pulse, be able to feel it alternating better if you're distal to the heart, if you're away from the heart. So, EKGs. So have you guys talked about PVCs and bigeminy and all that? So this is just the same thing, but you're feeling it instead of seeing it on an EKG. So you'll just feel that, and this is actually it's an irregular beat, but it's regularly irregular. I mean, you'll feel that weird, early, weak beat, every other beat. And you expect to see that on their EKG. People confuse this with alternans. So if you need to think about what the difference is, alternans, pulsus alternans is, it's alternating weakness of the beat, not earliness. So this is always early and weak, whereas alternans is regular, it's just weak every other beat. I mean, how do you describe a normal pulse? Rate of 72 beats per minute, and regular, normal intensity and contour, symmetric and synchronous bilaterally, femoral and radial pulses are synchronous. I mean, you don't have to put that on every single patient, but it pretty much touches on everything. And then you can look at that later. That just, again, is the different pulses. Just remember, the one that changes the inspiration is pulsus paradoxus. And it's cardiac tamponade usually, or it's a right. I mean, it's something is keeping the heart from filling well, and causing a lot of pressure on the right side. Extremities are pretty easy. We'll wrap it up. You just need to palpate for edema. What's the difference between pitting and non-pitting edema? Well, that's a pretty bad pitting edema. Yeah. So. Those are thumbprints. So you press into the skin and it stays like that for sometimes several minutes if it's really bad edema. My feet looked like that when I was about 39 weeks pregnant with my first kid. Now, the big thing clinically is, do both the feet look like that? Or does one foot look like that? Because that should be ding, ding, ding. I mean, if you have both legs like that, what's the first thing on your differential diagnosis list? Congestive heart failure, probably. Especially if it's dependent edema and it's not all the way. Like if their face isn't swollen, but their legs are horribly swollen, that's congestive heart failure. If their legs are that swollen and their face is swollen, that's nephrotic syndrome. I mean, they probably are in kidney failure. They're not able to put extracellular fluid back into their vasculature. And you'll learn more about nephrotic syndrome later. Do their feet look like that, but their belly is this big and distended out like a pregnant woman? What's that? Let's say it's a 65-year-old man. It's ascites. Yeah, it's a left liver failure. So when you see feet like that, there's things you need to be thinking of. Is their face swollen? Is their belly swollen? And is it both legs or one leg? I'll tell you a lot clinically.
And organ failure, you just got to figure out which organ.
Which organ, yeah. And so anasarca means they are swollen everywhere. So they'll have periorbital swelling. A good place to see if they have pitting edema is to check for presacral pitting edema, so push against the sacrum and see if it pits right there. And if it pits over their sacrum, it's anasarca. If it's just this tense, big, stretched out belly and you pull their shirt up and it looks like the timer's about to pop, that's liver failure. Okay? And liver failure causes right heart failure. Myxedema, which is due to thyroid disease, will not pit. Lymphedema, late stage lymphedema, like your breast cancer patients that have the arm that's been like this for 7 years since they've had a mastectomy and nose taken out, it won't pit. Eventually it won't pit. Early on it will pit, and you still have maybe some hope to save some of that tissue, but if it's been there for several years, that lymphedema in the arm won't pit anymore. So these are people with DVTs. Make a mental picture. Because sometimes it's skin changes. Sometimes you'll see that redness, you know, be swollen, congested looking, it's red. And it can even just be a subtle increase in diameter, in the size of the extremity diameter.
What's the similarity of all three of those pictures?
Asymmetry.
Unilateral swelling. And it would probably pit. I mean, if it's some dude with elephantiasis, probably won't pit because it's lymphedema. But if it'll pit, it's vascular occlusion probably somewhere. It's probably venous. The other way to tell that too is the venous occlusion legs, DVT legs, will feel warm. The skin will sometimes get shiny. Whereas if it's occlusion to an artery, it'll be cold, which, you know, makes sense. And then there's that word we like to use, ready and congested. So how do we grade pitting edema? There you go. Zero plus, I don't even know. 0 to 4 plus. Why is it just 0 to 4? I don't know, but 4 plus pitting edema, you can depress it 8 millimeters, and it takes at least 2 minutes for the skin to rise back up. You're not gonna sit there for 2 minutes and wait. You're just gonna kind of ballpark it on how far you can depress it. Okay, so some special tests. We'll go over these kind of quickly. You can actually test for pulsus paradoxus with the blood pressure cuff. And this is advanced physical exam type stuff that y'all aren't ready to do yet. When you study pulsus paradoxus, when you're reading about it, the main thing I want you to connect it to is cardiac tamponade, jugular venous distension, high pressures on the right side of the heart, high central venous pressures, things like that. But you can check for it. It actually will, I put the technique down there for you. It again goes with inspiration. Deep breaths will actually, the cork cough sounds will just go away with deep inspiration. Same way you'll have the drop in the pulse amplitude when you're feeling it. And also earlier on detect it with the blood pressure cuff. By feeling it that way, listening that way, rather by feel and listening. But again, get an echo if you suspect tamponade. If you see a leg like this, get out your measuring tape, pick a spot. You can see where somebody measured that lady. that they drew on her to make sure. I mean, you can measure from the inferior patella down to where you want to do the measurement to make sure at the same spot bilaterally, and then measure for the circumference. It may only be, you know, 1 or 2 centimeters, but, you know, if they've got more than a centimeter of difference, then there's probably a clot in there. So measuring limb circumference, and then check a Hohmann sign if you suspect a DVT. I mean, it's not a very sensitive test, but it's one of those tests where if you have a patient there and they have bilateral mild swelling and they're pretty sure they have a DVT, you can check a Hohmann's and just say, okay, I'm going to give you a test for DVT. I'm going to check this. You can tell them you have a negative Hohmann sign, you probably don't have a DVT, you know. But if the clinical signs of DVT don't correlate well with any kind of clinical diagnosis. I mean, it's very, very vague. So if you suspect it, you've got to get a sonogram. That's a malpractice type one, because if they go home and lay down and grow some clot to their lung and die, you know, and then they say, well, I told that PA I probably had a clot. You know, if you suspect at all, just get a sonogram. The sonographers, I have a sister that's a sonographer. They get tired of it, but it's better to just do the sonogram and make sure they don't have a clot. Because you really, they've studied it. There's just no good correlation between any clinical signs at all. But if you have somebody that you suspect a DVT, this is where you pull out your card, you ask some respiratory review systems, just to kind of make sure there's no pulmonary emboli. And then what other history would you want to take? Like, what would be really big, would be a really big risk factor for a DVT?
Drop surgery.
Just, yeah, I had a knee scope a week ago. Mm-hmm. Or they've been on an airplane, traveling, things like that. But surgery is the big, big one. Now, for peripheral arterial disease, you can do the ankle brachial index. Basically, you just measure the systolic blood pressure in the arm, you measure the systolic blood pressure in the ankle, and they should be pretty equal. If the ratio is less than 1, then that lower limb is not getting adequate flow. So that's just something clinically that you can order. Your bag is literally just taking the blood pressure in the leg, and comparing the two readings. So. All right. Is that a lot of info?
Mm-hmm. I have a biggie that's going to help you to know S1 to S2 of whether you're hearing lub or dub. Palpate the patient's pulse. When you feel the pulse, that's your S1 sound. Mm-hmm. That'll help you determine whether you've got a systolic or diastolic murmur by knowing which one's love and which one's dub. So love is S1, that's where you're going to fall.
All right, I'll take a break and then we'll demo the exam.